everyone. Thank you for staying connected with us. I hope you are all enjoying the sessions that we had today. We are back with another session now, for which I would like to invite Professor Bimal Roy. He is the head of R.C. Bose Center for Cryptology and Security, ISI Kolkata. He is also won a Padma Shri Award in Government of India in 2015. Welcome, sir. And next, I would like to invite Professor C.D. Kreese. She's a professor of cybersecurity in the Department of Computer Science at the University of Oxford. She leads the Oxford team's collaboration with the World Economic Forum's Shaping the Future of Cybersecurity and Digital Trust Platform. Welcome to the session today, C.D. Next, I would like to welcome Professor Sarun. He's a professor at IIT Delhi. His research is focused on computer networks and algorithms. He has actively been working in 5G technologies. Welcome, Professor Sarun, to the session today. And I would like to welcome the moderator of the session, Dr. Bhavani. She's the professor, chair, Department of Computer Science, University of Texas at Dallas. Her research interests have been at the intersection of cybersecurity, data science, artificial intelligence, including as well as they relate to policy and governance. With that, I will hand over the session to you, Dr. Bhavani. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Sonam, and thank you for inviting us to participate in the panel. And so, welcome everyone. And the panel's going to be on stronger security, resiliency, and privacy. And also, we cannot forget about data, speed, volume, diversity, and complexity. And with IoT sort of in mind, because we are hearing so much now about IoT, Internet of Things, it's very real. It encompasses almost everything, which includes networks and operating systems and databases and cloud. And so it is really critical that these IoT systems have to be secure. We have to ensure the privacy. At the same time, they have to be resilient. But we also have to handle massive amounts of data. We have this big data problem because lots of data are being collected. And there's the five V's: variety, volume, veracity, and so on, value. So we have put together a very distinguished group of panelists. And so this is the organization. Each panelist will talk for about 8 minutes on the specific topics. So our first panelist is Professor Bimal Roy, and he will be talking about secure communication with respect to IoT and also with respect to privacy. So that's going to be his focus. And then Professor Sadie Kreese, she's going to talk about aggregation of various systems, right? Because when you talk about IoT, as I said, there's many systems. So is the aggregate systems, what about the security concerns? And also, we are talking more and more about applying machine learning for cybersecurity and machine learning to detect anomalies and so on. And what happens if these machine learning techniques are attacked? So she'll also talk about security models for machine learning. And then the next panelist will be Professor Huzur Saran, and he will be discussing 5G security. That's going to be critical for IoT security, as well as he's also going to talk about scalability because we need scalable systems. Okay. So with that, I will turn it over to Professor Bimal Roy, and he gets around 8 minutes. So at the end, we are going to have questions, answers. And so if you can please type in the questions in the chat box, okay? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And good evening, or maybe good morning to the participants. I have the privilege of being the first speaker, so I can speak pretty much anything. And the others have to follow me. So that's unfortunate for them. The first topic that I would like to elaborate on is the notion of security and privacy. Both are important. And first, I'll start with a very, very simple thing that people have sometimes a wrong notion, and they cannot find the difference between security and privacy. So these two are totally different concepts. And so for example, if you think of the Bitcoin scenario, that a transaction is recorded appropriately. That is the security part. And nobody can identify who is transacting to whom. So my identity and also the receiver's identity is not disclosed. That is the privacy. So this is the two big differences. Sender, receiver, people don't identify. That's the privacy. And what is being transacted, say maybe I'm transferring half Bitcoin to maybe Sonam. So this transaction is not public, or nobody can understand this. This one is what we call security notion. So people often do some misunderstanding of these two concepts. And we have to ensure for a secure communication, both security and privacy. Once again, I repeat, privacy means the person who is communicating and the person receiving, that should not be understood unless we give them the freedom for others to know just through the network traffic, not even using these ML algorithms. Okay, so this is the challenge. And the security part is that what is happening between us, also that should not be readable by others. So how we achieve these things? You know, these things are pretty standard in the usual network domain. We use encryption technology, we use hash function, we use signatures, and so on and so forth. Now, these are pretty mature subject, and there are plenty of algorithms for achieving this one. But now the challenge comes when we get into an IoT network. Now, what is an IoT network? So it's just like a computer network, mostly wireless, but the nodes are not really a computer, not even a mobile phone. The nodes are small devices. We call this small, maybe a sensor or a very small device. And what is the feature of that? Small means, physically small, but also it has got limited memory, limited battery power, and also limited computational power. Now, what becomes a challenge now here in these two domains, using a notion of signature or a notion of hash function that we traditionally use in the usual communication scenario, or the encryption things we do, this public key encryption and so on and so forth. So these are not really appropriate for this IoT network. Just think of if I'm trying to use a key exchange using RSA, the simplest one, it needs to compute exponent of a large integer. The size of the exponent is very huge. Now, you have an idea how much time it takes, how much memory it takes? This usual IoT devices cannot compute this. Okay, so there's a restriction. Now people become aware. And as a result, NIST, the US government's National Institute for Standards and Technology, they had actually floated a competition for what they call lightweight cryptography, meaning that this cryptography has to be for lightweight things. Lightweight means limited battery power, limited computational power, limited memory. We have followed that suit. Also in India, also in the Data Security Council of India, we have also floated a national competition where students or researchers could actually submit algorithms for encryption, for signature, for authentication, for protocols, and so on and so forth. And this competition is on the way, and we're sure that we should be able to pick a few nice candidates which could be realizable, and government or the industry could use those things. So this is in the NIST model. Now this has become very important. And I just give an example of this notion of privacy. Suppose we put some, I have a home and I'm old, two old people live in the house. So we normally put a few sensors in my home, in a smart or advanced society. So that suppose there is a unusual generation of heat, that means there could be fire here, okay? Or there could be unusual sound, iPhone. Okay. Now these things could be caught by these IoT devices, and through a network it reaches the right place. So if it is like a heat, it might go to the fire station, this information. Now if it is it's a fall, it's a sound, it might go to the hospital. So depending on what kind of IoT network we have done, this information could go there. Now you think of this, maybe the some IoT device computes them. But now for this is very normal. So the numbers could for just to shield my identity. So there should be an algorithm for identity, no identity disclosure. So we have to define this framework in such a way that things are preserved the way we like. Now we just one little example we had for this IoT communication, RC4 algorithm was being used. The very simple, it could be, you know, run on a very, very small, simple device, hardly any memory, hardly any computation power needed, no battery power needed. So this was quite popular, even say 3-4 years back. But you know, many people attempted to break this system, and a group of researchers from my team, from this ISI Kolkata, we have completely broken it, led by Shubhamoy Mitra. So now RC4 is out of business. Because RC4, I think you could probably take a few hours, and I could actually break completely this any communication using RC4. So that's why we need very intelligent, very different kind of algorithm, very different from the traditional cryptographic methods. Okay, maybe I should stop now.
Roy, we've got to go to the next speaker. So if you can wrap it up, Professor Roy.
I think I've wrapped it up. So probably I'll stop here and let the.
Okay, this is great. There's a lot of questions. We are going to have a lot of discussion.
Yeah, sure. I'll be happy to answer.
Thank you. So the next panelist is Professor Sadie Kreese. So Professor Kreese.
Hello, and thank you so much for the kind invitation to join the panel. I wanted to share with you all some ideas born out of some ongoing work we have been conducting this year, specifically aimed at considering emerging technology environments and the current way in which we do cybersecurity throughout the whole cybersecurity life cycle. With a small amount of effort, are we likely to be able to translate these control mechanisms into these future environments, or are there some significant challenges that we face as a community? And that work has concluded a number of challenges, and I'm going to share a few of them with you today. So thank you to Professor Roy, because he has most brilliantly introduced the challenge around Internet of Things. And I'll start by showing a few thoughts on how we actually broaden that out, because as we understand it and as we know, the Internet of Things is of course already amongst us and is an evolving environment. And we will come to see more and more devices with computational capability, with communications capability, pervading our environments. And for some of us, we refer to that as ubiquitous connectivity. For others, we will stick with the Internet of Things. The issues, I suspect, one of the core ones is if we take account of all of these endpoints, as Professor Roy has just outlined, for which current security methods, like, for example, encryption, won't always be possible because of the resource limitations, imagine those kinds of limitations being applied across all of these devices. It won't just be cryptographic functionality that will be really difficult. If you wanted to do a form of intrusion detection at the host end, at the endpoints, that too will need computational resources. And in certain circumstances, of course, the functionality will be delivered via the cloud because of the connectivity back into the cloud. And then we will have to worry about the cybersecurity operations that we put around that. But the lens I wanted to introduce to you right now is one of a systems view, because we know that we have increasing dependency on these kinds of technologies, and that is only set to grow. Indeed, some of the biggest challenges that we face as a humanity and that face our economies are set to be solved by technology of this kind. And what happens in these environments, because we have all of these different devices producing all sorts of data, we have all sorts of relationships between human beings and technology, between technologies, supply chains, between businesses. And these kinds of relationships are set to grow and become much more dynamic. So what we face is quite a complex system. Huge amounts of data, huge amounts of information that can be derived from that data, highly dynamic relationships in the technology infrastructure, as well as in the human and organizational infrastructure. And I think one of the biggest concerns we are going to face is the fact that we obviously have the potential for aggregating risk. We know that harm propagates in the face of a cyber attack. And so it's not just the asset that's immediately attacked that we're concerned with. It's then what happens afterwards. Where does the attacker pivot? What are the ramifications for the rest of the organization? And where do they pivot from that organization outwards? And when we model the harm for an organization, whether that's a person, a country, or a business, we also know that those harms propagate too, and they build. So when we try and value losses resulting from cyber attacks, they can be really quite significant. And they don't just involve the immediate assets that might have been stolen or listened to, your secrets maybe, but it can also involve replacing the tech, replacing some people, rebuilding reputation, regulatory fines, all sorts of things come into play. And what we lack really as an international community right now are the tools to model that potential for aggregated and systemic risk, which means we don't know how to detect it happening. We don't have the early warning signs. And so we maybe do potentially face something that was really rather catastrophic, not unlike things like the COVID pandemic. So we urgently need to develop those models so that we can understand how this risk is aggregating and propagating across our systems. And remember, we have a tendency, don't we, to think about security as a chain and the weakest link, which is a very two-dimensional way, but very intuitive to us as people. But the reality of these systems that we're building is that there's many of those chains and they're interlinked. So it's almost a 3D system of chains that we're creating, and the harm and the risk propagates across that throughout our supply chains end to end. And then because of the dynamism of the relationships, it's almost four-dimensional. And some of these relationships will persist and stand a long length of time, and others are just going to be spun up for a particular transaction and then taken down again. So that was the first point I wanted to make, and that's to do with the need for us to understand these systemic properties, which all of these different component parts that we need to protect, of course, feed into. If we cannot protect an endpoint, a particular device, then that is a way into that system, and that can cause one of these propagation ripple effects. And that brings me to the next point around IoT, and it's this, isn't it? That we know for a fact, even today, modern enterprises find it really hard to understand where all of their technology assets are. What is the value of the data? Where does it all sit? How many devices are connected to my system? What is where at any one time? So we can accredit a security architecture as being fit for purpose, But because our world and our business changes so rapidly, the system probably changes within a few weeks. And so the question on our minds is, how do we prepare for those kinds of futures where it's going to be increasingly hard to understand where the perimeter or the boundary is? And the observation I wanted to make for you today on this panel was, it's time for us to consider that there is an insider in every environment. So although we would never say take down the boundary measures, give up on the access control, absolutely not, we must do it. But we must also prepare for the fact that the bad comes within and can be attacking from within the systems. And so never more so than with the Internet of Things, because of the difficulty in understanding where the boundaries are and the fact that they can change so much. And what does that mean? Well, it means that we have to accept not just the fact of zero-day attacks, but we have to move away from a paradigm where we construct our security mechanisms based upon assuming we have foresight and that somebody will have seen this kind of vulnerability or this kind of attack vector before. We cannot just assume that. We must hope for that and put all of the operational support in place to design the patches, to roll them out, to take down the attack surface. But we also need to prepare for the insider threat. And for that, we really need to do more on anomaly detection. We need to do better at understanding what good looks like and unthreatening looks like, so that we can begin to get a gut instinct for when things are changing for the worse. Not unlike, actually, what Professor Roy was talking about with the cyber burglars who were working out normal in an IoT environment at home to know when you weren't at home, so they know to go and burgle your house. Well, that's the bad people using anomaly detection, and we need to do much more of that on the defense side. And then my final point, really, just pivoting away from anomaly detection and the Internet of Things is something around data. And we've been considering very hard AI in its current form, deep machine learning, which we all know is benefiting from this huge amount of data that we're producing, which enables us to better understand the world and to look for these weak signals and these patterns. And yes, we have an issue, undoubtedly, which is that these kinds of technologies will be in the hands of cyber attackers, which means we think it's going to make some cyber attacks more potent. So if you think about kill chains and the early stages, reconnaissance and actually delivering payloads or trying to stay persistent on a system and to avoid detection, all of those kinds of activities will be helped by any technology that helps you speed up and be more precise. But my final comment would be this. So not only do we need to be able to measure the potency of that, but just to close, it's undoubtedly the case that machine learning is going to bring about huge benefits to humankind, and more organizations are going to be using it and the data that the IoT will deliver to feed it. And that makes machine learning an asset that we need to protect. And so in conclusion, I would just like to observe that we as a community need to really start developing the security models, the operational cybersecurity we put around the machine learning asset. What does it mean for us to be able to maintain integrity in those situations? And with that, I know my time is up. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Chris. So I'm really learning from you and Professor Roy. So we'll see what Professor Saran has to say. So our next panelist is Professor Saran, and he's going to talk about 5G security and some other things like scalability. So again, thank you.
So thanks for having me on the panel. And my previous two panelists have made some very interesting points, Professor Roy and Sidi. And I agree that as we're moving forward, one part of the picture is this massive amount of data that is being collected and analyzed. And of course, the strength of machine learning comes from the fact that at very large scale, these kinds of algorithms can start figuring out even low probability events and building relationships around it, which are otherwise not possible to do. And so that is why those machine learning algorithms are becoming so effective, because of the access of huge amounts of data. But on the flip side, that also means all our data is getting collected. And as Professor Roy said, that that also means everything about you is known. So what is your privacy? And that is the second concern. And now all of this is happening with whatever is today. As you know, in the last 10 years, everything has gotten more and more mobile. We are having now, everybody is using their cell phone and being, even some people are attending meetings through their cell phones now, rather than through a laptop and desktop, which we used to be the norm for video conferencing even 3 years ago, perhaps. So what is happening with 5G? Of course, these Gs are basically generational improvements. So there's nothing like actually a mark saying that you go into 5G now. But 4G already has gotten better and better. And very soon, now all the devices that are being sold, the latest phones are all 5G. What does it mean? What does 5G mean to us? Well, of course, it means more bandwidth. Fancier videos, 4K and 8K videos now rather than just 720p or 480p videos. But that's not the main concern. The main concern is that everything is now becoming, wireless is becoming pervasive. Millions, billions, trillions of devices are being put on your phone, your watch, your sensor in your shoe, right, which is measuring your steps, calculating your BMI. You know, so much information is being gathered through so many sensors, and now you want them instantaneously available all the time. And 5G is this effort. Like within your home, you had Wi-Fi, which was giving you the ability to connect most of your information. But when you step out of your home, that connectivity was not always there. So with 5G, we are moving to an always, everywhere connected sort of model, right? And devices from very low-end devices to very high-end devices are all going to be part of this. My personal area network will tie into my cell phone and through that communicate with the rest of the world, right? And that is the picture emerging in 5G. And for example, something completely different, it also enables very new kinds of models. So people talk about vehicular networks. People talk about the fact you all already seeing autonomous or near autonomous cars. And people say in the highway, when you everybody is driving on the highway, of all you need to do is maintain distance between the cars. So that can be done automatically. So cars can keep talking to each other and form a platoon, and then the whole flow on the highway would be smoother. This is what vehicular people have been studying. But here now, there's a bunch of cars. Not all the cars are from the same organization. As Sadie said, the differentiation, the boundaries between organizations are getting very, very fluid. Now, if all these cars are from different organizations, there are people sitting in there and driving their car. And of course, they're also watching and maybe participating in movies and all, in meetings and all that, or entertainment. And these cars need to keep talking to each other and trust what they're telling each other. So if the car in front of me says, hey, somebody braked, so you also braked, right? Maybe he's fooling me. He's telling me to brake when there is nothing, no reason to brake. I brake and the guy behind me bangs me, right? So it can be misused also. So, but I need to be able to trust who's telling me this information. Only then I can use it. And this is not just one example, cars. You talk about any other scenario, AR, VR. You know, people talk about using augmented reality and virtual reality and in the wireless space, right? Again, many of these things will be used to deliver real services. I'm not just talking about game playing. Game playing is one part, but AR, VR for real things is also being examined. You walk in and the AR, VR can tell you where you are. You will be partly, information will be coming to you about things that are around you. So many scenarios people are already, if you look at any, talks all over the place, many such technologies are being developed, and security is going to be a key part of it. And the other part of this picture is, for all this AR, all of this to work well, you need a lot of computation. The computation cannot be then done only on your device, which is a battery powered device. As Professor Roy said, many of these devices, even doing strong cryptographic computation on them, is not feasible because the devices have severely limited capabilities. But still we want to be able to do it. So what we are saying is, okay, they'll take advantage of the cloud. But there's a catch. The cloud is maybe far away. It's 100 millisecond round trip away. So people talk about doing what is called edge computing. you say, okay, there'll be a bunch of servers sitting in the service providers next to your base station, your 4G, 5G base station, and the compute will be offloaded to there. How secure is that? That information is being exchanged between your application and the nearby edge compute server. Now, at the edge compute, millions of other applications are also using that edge compute. What if one edge compute malicious application hacks through that and can through that access many, many more data of many other users? What is the mechanism for that? What kind of even, how do you certify that your, as a service provider, your cloud, edge cloud is secure? What kind of models, what kind of testing will you have to do for this? And remember, all of this is very dynamically evolving. Every day an app gets updated. You know, on your phone, every time you look at it, you find 20 more updates are pending for you. Now, every update, what does it mean? It means some logic in that application has changed. How will you verify that the new logic is safe? Or the earlier one may have been safe, this one may not be. So all along, we need also more sophisticated techniques, maybe using verifiability and language verification techniques, for example, and many other techniques we need. And still it has to be cost effective, because you cannot do large computation on low-end devices. And so these are posing many, many interesting problems. I don't think in 5-6 minutes we can propose solutions, and I don't think there are easy solutions. But the notion of trust, the notion of privacy, the notion of security, what does it mean? All of this needs to be much more better quantified and formalized, perhaps. I'll stop here in the interest of time.
Yeah, thank you very much. This was very, very interesting. So the audience, please post your questions, because we don't see any questions. But in the meantime, I'm going to ask a question to each of the panelists. So I'll start with Professor Roy. So you talked about, so the question to Professor Roy, you talked about security versus privacy. Then there is also reliability, safety. One of the panel topics was on resiliency. So how do you think, Professor Roy, that we can have all of this? What are the trade-offs? Can you give some of your thoughts on that? We can't hear your...
Mike.
Please switch it on.
See, yes. If I had infinite memory, infinite computational power, I could accommodate all these things that you are looking for. So it's just like if I had infinite money, I could buy anything from the market. Problem comes, I have limited maybe 100 rupees in my pocket, so what best I can do? So again here, it all depends on the amount of memory available to me, the amount of battery power available to me, the amount of social network communication, what is the RF range of this IoT devices. It may not go more than 100 meters. It may go up to 1 kilometer. So this is all function of these things. And we have to make compromises. Now, if you want to make it more secure, privacy will be probably a little bit compromised. So this is a very strong optimization problem. And once I know what is the exact scenario that you can give me as a technology, then I can and see what the level of security, level of privacy, level of resiliency you want. Accordingly, we have to design something. And this is not an easy problem. We are still working on it. I have no panacea for that. So we have to work case by case.
Okay, so there's another question for you, but I'll come back to you. So yes. The next question is for Professor Kreis. You had talked about these machine security models for machine learning, right? Because again, these machine learning techniques, algorithms could be attacked. So when you talk about security models, are you sort of proposing sort of formal models, formal verification of the machine learning algorithms? Could you sort of talk a little bit about that?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm proposing that we need to design a security model, and that might involve a number of different components. As you say, I mean, the first thing, of course, is to recognize the variety of attack surfaces. There is both the data that we train machine learning algorithms with. There's the model that we're developing in that training phase that may need protecting We have a pre-deployed model that we're about to put into an environment that will need protecting. Once the model is in the environment, if it's a generative model, so if it's designed to learn from experience, then it will both have a feedback input loop, which may be human directed or directly sensed from the network. That data surface may need protecting. And then the model that's evolving, that's being generated, may also need protecting. And the right approach to delivering a security will have to think about the different.
There's some background noise.
I'll carry on and do my best. The security model would need to consider those different aspects. And then we have the properties that the security model needs to deliver. And there's been a lot of focus, hasn't there, on explainability of mm-hmm. decisions that are being recommended from these algorithms. And then judging whether those decisions are free from bias or have the right levels of integrity in relation to what was intended. Right. And some of this, I think, we may be able to reason about designs and algorithms and data sets up front around using different forms of reachability or computational modeling. And other aspects of the security model will almost certainly be in operation protection methods that we put around these things as they're used.
That's really very, very interesting answer. And so maybe I'll follow up with you later on that. I'm quite interested. So here is a question. It was for Professor Roy, but this is also very relevant for what Professor Saran was talking about. So question is, and this is also very India specific, when could we expect 5G to be implemented by BSNL in India? So when can you expect that? And Professor Saran, can you talk about that?
Sure.
So, that's better. Let him speak.
Yeah. Thanks.
And then Professor Roy, I'd like to think your opinions too.
Okay. So First of all, I think let me not talk about one operator, but 5G in India. I think already there was an India Mobile Congress last week, and a couple of operators have committed to launching 5G in India by the end of next year, 2021. Of course, right now, Government of India has not even issued licenses for 5G spectrum. So it also depends on government policy, but we would expect end of next year or early 2022 is when you would see launches of 5G in India. Of course, in the advanced countries, I believe it has already happened for most of the major countries. Yeah.
So do you have any thoughts, Professor Roy?
No, actually, I would also love to get it by end of next year, which I think is feasible from the technology point of view. But, you know, in India, the bureaucracy is there. The government has to, you know, give permission. They have to float tenders and so on and so forth. And I have no idea how long that is going to take. But I think technologically, things are ready to be implemented by by September of 2021. Okay. So let's hope for the best.
Right. So I have another question on 5G. But before that, to Professor Kreese, so what about, how is the 5G, how advanced is 5G in the UK? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's quite well advanced, different functionalities in different kinds of rollouts in different parts of our environment. And actually, when we were studying Internet of Things, we had the privilege to observe all sorts of different projects outside of the UK, for example, in Singapore and their future airport infrastructures. So we're definitely seeing some significant rollout and people preparing new kinds of functionality that will sit above these frameworks. Mm-hmm. It's exciting times.
It is. And so talking about 5G, this is to Professor Roy as well as to Professor Saran. You all have talked about 5G. So my question is what are the limitations of 5G with respect to Internet of Things? Because we are talking about now, as I said, it's not just a network, or it's a network of networks, systems of systems, as Professor Kreese said, right? We've got to put everything together and aggregate stuff. So what are the limitations of 5G? So Professor Saran, can you give your thoughts? And then Professor Roy?
Well, I think one essential problem. Limitation of 5G is that the biggest limitation is not widely rolled out. Even the places where they say they have rolled it out, if you actually ask for 5G coverage, you get it only in a small patch of the city. Even London, you will not get it other than central London. In Oxford, you probably in the city, you will get it. You drive 1 mile out of Oxford and you may not get it. Because the cost of deploying this new technology at very large scale to cover the whole country is an enormous cost. And operators, of course, will not put that money in there unless the revenue justifies it. And the flip side is, if I have to deploy an application, suppose I'm a gas company supplying gas all over, pumped natural gas all over a certain area. If only 50% of my meters will have 5G, and the other 50% of the area 5G will not be there, then it doesn't make sense for me to move to 5G based meters. See, unless almost all my subscribers are covered, I can't roll in an application based on 5G. So it's that same chicken and egg problem with all network or infrastructure technologies, that it's hugely costly to deploy. The value comes in when it's largely deployed, and then the cost of everything is down. So that's, I think, the bottleneck here is just 5G is very new. It takes a little bit of time for the scale to come. I think that's the core problem.
So, Professor Roy, do you have something to add? And what do you think about 5G security? Yeah.
No. So, I think that it's secured, but I'm still not very sure whether my IoT devices can support 5G. So, that's the technology part. Maybe the mobile phones will be able to support 5G. This current, maybe iPhones can certainly support. But if I'm thinking of a small device, IoT device, I have to really study it more carefully, see whether it can support 5G. I would guess no.
Okay.
Kind of requirements 5G will have, small devices, I would guess probably will not have that. So for the IoT devices, 5G is still far off. That's my
question. We are having very good discussion. So we started 5 minutes late, so we've got 4 minutes left. So I would like sort of a closing statement, what you all think the biggest challenges with IoT, security, big data, from a security privacy. So we'll again start, go in order. First, and you have just over a minute for this. So Professor Roy, and then Professor Chris, and then Professor Saran. So Professor Roy, your closing argument.
I am quite concerned about the power of machine learning, because we put all the IoT data on a cloud. Okay, and if machine learning algorithm designed by Hujur or SADI becomes so good, my privacy ultimately becomes compromised, then I'm afraid of that. Okay, so my security model has to take care that no machine learning algorithm can learn myself. They may learn certain things, but should not be able to learn my identity. Okay. So there are issues like that. So this is, you know, 2% zero-sum game. We have to have some game theoretic approach here. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a very good point. So, Professor Chris, what do you have to say? We have 3 minutes left, so you have got just over a minute, and then Professor Saran.
So that concerns me too, Professor Roy. I think the new one I'm going to add into the mix is this issue of orchestration and the systems view, because if some of these devices can't run the security functionality or they can't engage with certain bits and pieces, the big challenge we face is, how do we orchestrate? So how do I make sure that I'm paying attention to Professor Roy's security needs whilst I'm also delivering my commercial needs? And how do I bring together these different parts? Data, information, knowledge, people, service, protect all of it and understand how that risk can propagate.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was good. It sort of complements what Professor Roy said. And Professor Saran, what do you think some of your closing points and, the future?
Thanks. So my point is that, in the end, I think it's a people challenge. You know, the kind of people who understand systems, technology, and also care enough about security. I'm not saying they understand security. They also need to care about it enough. And that we are not, even today, I don't think most of the engineers we train, they care about performance, they care about functionality, they care about building interesting things, but do they care about making it secure? Are they anal about that? Very small fraction of those people. And the point is, as already mentioned by Sadi, the nature of security is it's a hard problem. It's a multidimensional problem. Links can break anywhere and then that can propagate through. And the point is, you don't get paid for worrying about it. You think about it. Every organization, every large company, you know, there is a chief security officer. And everybody else thinks this guy is a nuisance. I'm not going to make money by making things more secure. And that is the fundamental disconnect, right? And so I would say it's partly a people problem. Just look at this pandemic. You know, everybody knew pandemic was going to come. Lots of reports for 10 years had said a pandemic will come. But only the experts cared about it. Everybody else didn't care about it. And now suddenly we have a pandemic and everybody is going crazy.
Right.
So it's the same thing. You know, bad things can happen. They happen rarely. So we as humans don't want to think about the bad thing. Right. That's the human nature. Right.
Right. So that is great. So we've had, you know, wonderful panelists. And that's now, it's, we have, I think India time is, you know, just 50 minutes. So we started 5 minutes late. So we are exactly 45 minutes, the panel. And so at this time, and again, it was an easy job for me because the panelists were so good. So, and we can go for another 45 minutes. But again, at this time, I will hand it over to the organizers. Yes, we have Sonam and Sonam. So Sonam, do you want to take it from here? Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you
so much, all the panelists, for your time. And this indeed was a very engaging session. And I'm sure everybody enjoyed this. So thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.